Welcome to this video regarding the Introduction to Procedure Qualification Record, or PQR. So, if you are preparing for the CWI exam, or an engineer who had a task that requires checking or reviewing this scanned document, tune in till the end. I'll also give out a coupon code for my Udemy course, where you get a discount. Also, please leave a like if this video helps, and subscribe to this channel as well. It truly helps a lot. Now, let's dive right in. PQR, or Procedure Qualification Record, is the record of variables during the welding of the test coupons. It also contains the test results of the tested specimen. It establishes the properties of the weldment and not the skill of the welder. The aim of the PQR is to demonstrate that during these tests, the materials and methods prescribed in the welding procedure specifications will produce a weld joint with the mechanical properties that will meet the application and the relevant codes and standards that is specified in the WPS. Note that it qualifies the weldment, not the skill of the welder. As you can see, the WPS and PQR is written very similar, but they have a lot more differences that it shows. WPS is like a written procedure or methodology that describes how the welder will complete the welds. PQR, in the meantime, qualifies if it will meet the mechanical properties of the material. As you can see here, both the WPS and PQR lists the base metal, the filler metal, the electrode classification, the welding current, and the voltage properties of the welding machine, and among others. But what they differ is that the WPS is the specification that is used to create the weld. But the PQR lists all of the parameters that are used during the qualification of that weld. That's a major difference between the two. But how does the PQR differ? Aside from the definition I stated, here are the contents of the PQR. Note that the contents of the PQR varies depending on the governing codes and standards. Note also that you may have multiple WPS qualify a single PQR, or multiple PQRs qualify a single WPS. Depending upon the codes and standards that the PQR adheres to, or the welding procedure specification complies to, there are three variables that are needed to be identified. The first one is the essential variables. This is considered to affect the mechanical properties of the weldment and shall require the requalification of the WPS should any of these parameters change. For example here, base metal definitely affects the mechanical properties. Thickness, because it affects the allowable stress. Filler metal types, because the weld metal and base metal must have equal strengths. Heat treatment, like the preheat and post-weld heat treatment, because it affects the hardness and weldability of the metal. Later, I will show the tabulation showing the different parameters that are needed for the essential variables. Typical essential variables depends on the welding process as well. It's not the same for everything. For example, SMAW or SMAW, or shielded metal arc welding, does not require a shielding gas. So, you should not expect that shielding gas to be an essential variable. Supplementary essential variables. These essential variables required for metals whose referencing code, standard, or specification requires toughness test, and are in addition to the essential variables for the welding process. If the test does not require toughness test, such as CharPy or IZOD, then these variables will not be essential. Non-essential variables. These variables, if changed, as described in the specific variables, may be made in the WPS without requalification. Examples of which are arc voltage, welding current, travel speed. Here's an example of the tabulation of essential, supplementary, and non-essential variables in asminine. The parameters in the WPS is indicated in the rows and indicated whether or not these are essential, supplementary, or non-essential variables. You might have these questions in mind. For essential variables, it needs to be addressed. But what if you don't need them? If you do not need to indicate these variables, for example, preheat, post-weld heat treatment, as some materials do not require them, like carbon steel pipes with thickness below 20 mm, just indicate none. When do these supplementary variables become essential? These supplementary variables become essential when impact tests are required per code. Typical instance where impact tests are required is when welding in subarctic temperatures, where the ductile brittle temperature, as you can see here, can be reached. This is where impact tests will be deemed necessary to ensure the weld quality and its soundness. Soundness is the freedom from imperfections of the weld. If you address the non-essential variables, do you need to comply to it? Yes. For example, if a non-essential variable is specified like the weld technique, if it's specified to be string only or weave only, then the welder must follow it. You do not need to fill up every non-essential variable if it is not applicable to the process you're in. Just like I mentioned when using shielding gas for SMAW, it's just not applicable. These are the three methods to qualify a weld: pre-qualified procedures, actual procedure qualification testing, and weld mockups. EWS D1.1 specifies typical welding processes like the ones mentioned here. For example, if the weld falls under one of these processes, SMAW, GMAW, FCAW, and does not exceed the parameter limits of the qualification, then depending upon the code, the WPS can be used without a PQR, meaning the WPS is already pre-qualified. Note that if the WPS is pre-qualified, it does not mean you do not need to write them. You still need to. Because, as I've mentioned earlier, the WPS is the written document that the welder follows to adhere to the specifications that the standard or code it complies with. So upon listing the essential variables, here are some of the tests needed to qualify the WPS. Bend test, conducted to evaluate the ductility and soundness of weld joints. Soundness is defined as the freedom of the weld from discontinuities and defects. Tension test, conducted to evaluate the strength and ductility of not just the weld metal, but the base metal and the weldment. Fracture test, this is the one that I mentioned that is needed for the supplementary essential variables. These are the impact tests. The most common here is the Charpie V-notch impact test. It is used to determine the resistance of the extension of a crack in a metal. Nick break test, it's used almost exclusively for pipelines described in API 1104. Similar to the bend test, it is used to judge the soundness of the weld by fracturing the specimen through the weld. Note that these tests depend on the welding code or standard that the weld will adhere to. Here's the table in ASME9 specifying the tests and number of specimens needed to qualify the weld. As you can see here, it is tabulated the type of tests mentioned earlier, like the tension test, bend test, etc., and the thickness of the weld coupon. These will be the parameters needed to identify the number of specimens needed to qualify the weld. Again, the number of specimens as well will depend in which code or standard that the WPS will comply to. Now, these destructive tests needs to have a separate discussion altogether. I might make a video about it, so stay tuned. Finally, here's the summary of steps in qualifying the WPS. Select the appropriate welding variables, especially the essential variables. For supplementary essential, check code requirements for impact tests. Check the equipment and materials for suitability. Monitor weld joint fit-up and actual welding. Record all important variables such as current, voltage, etc. Document every parameter, just like writing a laboratory report. Test and evaluate the specimen as prescribed in the appropriate standard. Ensure that the number of specimens used in these tests are followed per code or standard. Review test results for compliance with the applicable code or standard. Release approved procedure for production if these tests are deemed to be acceptable. Qualify individual welders in this specification. Now that I mentioned earlier that the PQR only qualifies the weldmen and not the individual welders used. So you need to have a separate welder qualification test to qualify the individual welders that will be utilized for that specific production weld. Monitor the use of that procedure during production. Welding inspector shall provide constant feedback to the engineer regarding the performance of the specifications. Now, it is up to the CWI to monitor if the WPS is indeed suited for the production welds by ensuring that the production welds are tested, inspected, and passed. Finally, document all the test results from the laboratory. Since the tests may be done by a third-party laboratory, these documents must be kept. There you have it. If you have any questions, feel free to comment down below. As I've mentioned earlier, I will leave a discount code for my Udemy course in the link below, valid for 30 days upon the upload date of this video. So don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to this channel. Thank you for watching.